Good evening, everybody. We're reconvening our Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, March 7th. Unfortunately, we had a teleconference for an executive session, so the approval of minutes and warrants were not, and public access was not videotaped. We're on to agenda item number three, signing of a mortgage agreement. Mr. Jones, the floor is yours, sir.
Al Jones, Assessor's Office. I got a call the other day that people on 45 Lake Road are, they have a mortgage for the town of Brookfield for $12,000. From 1986, it's zero interest. They don't have to pay it back until they sell it. What we need to do is, this has happened five times in the past, every time they refinance, the town comes second behind the bank. So what I did was I just duplicated a previous agreement, word for word, from I think it's 2007, it's in here. And if you folks can sign this, all it's saying is that when they finally sell the house, the town gets $12,000. But I wanted to make sure that if there were any questions, you know, this is not something that is available now as a loan. It was done as a low income, like a fixer-up loan way back. And there can't be too many of these left around. I don't think there are any left in Brookfield. We looked all over the place to find things on it. The owner acknowledges that he owes $12,000 upon the sale of the house, but he's not in any hurry to go anywhere, so this will remain. This might be the last time it happens, but there'll be notes on the property record card, and I'm also going to meet with Kerry to make sure that that she knows how to account for it down the line, if not already, just because it's been so long.
So two questions. First and foremost, have they paid anything back from the $12,000?
Nothing. Nothing is due.
Second question, are they current on their property taxes?
I wouldn't know that. That would be tax collector.
I'm sure they are.
I'm not going to go off on it. I'm sure they are. Are we okay to table this until we find out where we're at with property taxes?
It's holding up the refinancing right now.
So I will entertain a motion.
I can say that in talking with Brenda, she's aware of what we're doing here. She did not raise the issue that they were behind in anything. Not that I asked her to look, but she's usually pretty good on who's who.
So I'm going to entertain a motion to allow the board to sign said document under the stipulation that all taxes are current. Therefore, we won't sign it tonight. It'll be in the selectman's office. Once we check it tomorrow, then we can all come in and sign based on this vote.
So I will tell the people that it'll be signed
once we confirm that the taxes are paid.
And that could be tomorrow. Later this week, next week? You'll all come in? Tomorrow. At least two people. I need two.
Yeah.
Tomorrow.
Okay. If that's what you're comfortable, that's why I wanted to make sure I was here to explain that.
Are we okay with that motion?
Yeah, I'll make the motion.
Get a second.
So, Karen, are you following up with Brenda on that?
Yeah, I will.
Not that I don't like being in the middle, but I don't want to be in the middle, so.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your service. Item number four. What's that? It's not 6 o'clock yet. Item number four, there's no need to vote on this, but we will acknowledge. As of February 22nd, 2017, I am resigning from my position on the Board of Assessors. Between my advancing age and the effects of lymphoma cancer, God bless them, I've endured for the last year, I find I lack the full recovery of my memory and mental faculties to continue to be effective in performance of the job. Thank you for the privilege of serving the town. Sincerely, Philip H. Pierce. So if you can acknowledge that and send a letter of appreciation from the Board of Selectmen. This we do have to take a vote on. I will entertain a motion to accept Officer Cowden's letter of resignation effective March 31st, 2017. I'm writing to formally advise you that effective March 31st, 2017, I am resigning from my position as a Brookfield police officer. This decision has been a difficult one, as I have enjoyed working in your department. Working for you and with you has provided me with many positive experiences and learning opportunities. Thank you so much for providing me with the opportunity to fulfill my dream of becoming a police officer. I have gained immense knowledge due to the your guidance, and I have enjoyed working with you. I wish the Brookfield Police Department every success in the future, and thank you again for the opportunities you've given me during my time here. Sincerely, Paul Cowden. Entertain a motion to accept with regret.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Is he full-time or part-time?
He's full-time.
Full-time.
Any discussion?
No.
And if we could send him a letter of appreciation as well. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Still not 6 o'clock. Item number 5, the MPPF library grant.
Yes, we helped run the way of that.
You helped?
Yes.
Well, thank you. The Board of Selectmen of the Town of Brookfield is pleased to support the Massachusetts Historical Round 23 application filed by the town's Merrick Library Bannister Memorial Hall. The Board of Trustees and Library Director of the Merrick Public Library have worked meticulously over the past 20 years in preserving the town's historic public library. With the town's support, they have made the building ADA compliant to the extent necessary of a historical building on the National Register. They continue to present projects on an annual basis for the historic preservation of the significant and unique architectural features of the structure. Round 23 application is essential and deserving request for assistance, allowing the front facade to be preserved and preserved and restored. The Board of Selectmen is pleased to offer this letter of support and wishes to recognize the Merrick Public Library for the contribution to the larger Brookfield community. I will entertain a motion to allow the chair to sign.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Discussion. This is a application for a grant. I believe it's $12,000 matching grant.
Yes.
And it is, so I'm going to, through the motion, allow the chair to sign all related documents. And the matching funds are within their accounts already. Any further?
No,
any further discussion? Do we have a motion? Oh, we do have a motion. All in favor?
Aye.
We only have to sign one, right, Karen? That's ours. So if there's anything else, the motion allows us to sign. With it being 6 o'clock, I am going to recuse myself for item number 6. The floor is yours, ma'am.
Okay, I'd like to open the poll here. Do we have a representative?
Yeah, he's here.
I'd like to make a motion to open.
Sir?
Yes.
I'll make a motion. Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Wow. Okay, could you give us a little information about that?
So I'm DJ Alberti. I'm a representative of National Grid. So we have one new customer on Wells Road. The work that we need to do would just consist of one pole just crossing the street, and then their service will be going underground from the pole. So we need one pole just to obtain the underground. So it's just one pole directly across the street from. I'm drawing a blank, the pole number, but there's a pole adjacent right from it, so it's not even that far around. I think it's only about 30 feet, just the length of the road itself. And there's no anchoring or guying needed because it's close enough. So it's just one single pole.
Okay. So. Do we have any discussion or any objections from the audience on this pole here? Okay. I'd like to take a vote, a motion on that.
I'll make the motion to approve the poll.
Any discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Awesome. Thank you.
I
motion to close the hearing?
Oh, I'm sorry. Close the hearing. Like, make a motion to close the hearing?
I did that.
Oh, you did?
You can second it for me.
I'll second it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, guys. Item number six, signing the email contract. Karen, if you'd like to weigh in on this, since you've been working on it.
Okay, what happened is, we did manage to save a little bit of money. At first, I thought this is about the email contract. They charge us $50 per year per person for each email. And it was coming out to quite a bit of money. I think it was, what's the figure you have there? This is for the setup fee.
$5,300.
Right. And it was...
So it's 66 users for $3,300.
It was, I think, it was 42, I think. It was saved $950. However, they also charge $50 per year and a $50 setup fee for each additional email that we have. So what I did is, even though we saved the money on one end, we also had to pad it because I'm sure in fiscal year 18 we're going to have more emails. So we ended up saving, well, we will save about $500 or $600 as long as we don't have any new emails. We expect to have at least a few more. So.
Does, the only question I have is capacity. Does this affect the capacity?
Well, I will tell you, Mr. George is an expert. I mean, he's the firefighter that does several other towns, and he knows the problems that we've been having with the email. The whole purpose that he set this up is so we wouldn't have that problem anymore. I don't know the technicalities of it, but I know he's on top.
Good. Thank you.
Any other questions for Karen? Yes. Entertain a motion to allow the chair to sign the contract for $5,300.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Just sure. Item number seven, more fishing derbies, special use permits. I will entertain a motion to allow the use of Quabog Pond on 7/16/17 to the Bass Alliance.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
From 5 to 2. We'll just do them all together.
Yep.
South Pond on 6/10/17 for the Mass Bass Alliance from 5 to 2. So I'll entertain a motion for both.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Yep. Item number 8. The ABCC is requiring a number of residents provided by the town clerk of 3,368. I will entertain a motion to allow the board to sign said document.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
No, what is this?
I have to file with the ABCC of how many residents there'll be on July 10th, 2017.
Okay.
And the proposed
summer residences.
Proposed is 3,368. Okay. Do we have a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Yes, second.
Any discussion?
Okay.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Item number 9, the advisory board. A budget discussion. There was a note from the secretary bringing to the attention that there's several departments basically under one individual that it's my son, I apologize, that will not appear for the meeting in regards to their budget discussion. We discussed this prior, and we stated that that individual should attend. He refuses to attend, so discussion.
I don't think that he's refusing to attend. He's refusing to attend with the presence of the chairman of the advisory board because there is an open complaint between the two individuals.
That's going to be resolved tonight. Are we in agreement with that?
I'm hopeful.
Yeah.
Okay. He stated the same thing to me last week when I talked to him about it.
Even with the open complaint, I don't think it's a liable complaint. We have word from town council that it doesn't hold water. The individual should attend the meeting. I attended the meeting last night, and the discussion revolved around level funding his budget or actually charging with him with insubordination, which I think that's the route I would go if he doesn't attend. We're talking about a large budget for the town that he should get past petty grievances and represent his department for a discussion with the committee.
He's not here, so we should not be discussing.
No, we can. We're his boss. We discussed it prior. We stated that he should attend the meeting, and he did not attend the meeting. He did refuse to attend the meeting.
He did not. He refused to meet with that committee, with that chairman.
And I believe it's unfounded, so what do we want to do?
I don't believe it's unfounded.
Linda?
No, my suggestion was having a joint meeting.
That's
with the Board of Selectmen.
We're not in kindergarten. It's a very respectful board. He's met with the committee before. I've actually had people approach me today that heard wind of this and said they've seen tapes. Sharon used to actually tape those meetings, and they were very civil. And there was animosity. Day one, when I entered this board, there was animosity between the two individuals.
Exactly.
Well, would he attend if one of us came in? I mean.
But why would you have to do that? What are you going to do that the other members of that board can't help?
Then we just take the budget as it is.
Yeah, if he doesn't, that's what.
Is that goes. That's fair to the townspeople to level fund the budget and for them to stand on town floor and change it without a discussion by the advisory committee?
Well, he's proposed a budget. Yeah. The budget's going to the advisory board. The advisory board can advise based on the budget that he's provided. That's pretty straightforward. What's the purpose of the discussion?
I was going to discuss that too. If he's already, submitted what he wants, and if they feel that there's any, they want to make any cuts to it, and they do, and then it's cemented on the town floor.
Yeah.
That's silly. That's so
well,
wrong.
I think that's how we've handled it in the past. I mean,
no,
he's
met in the past with the advisory committee.
Yeah, but I mean, but I remember though when other boards have not met. We've just level funded the budget for what they've given us.
We're talking about a highway budget. We're talking about a tree warden budget. We're talking about a shade tree budget.
Yep.
Well, would a representative from that department come up with me?
What do you mean?
If he won't come up with would the secretary come up?
She is also under those conditions now.
Dave, did you want to say something? Come on up. Welcome, sir.
Evening. John Holcraft, advisory board chairman. You know, we're running a town here, okay? We're not playing kidney garden here. We had a big budget. My board members last night discussed that they have lots of questions, okay? We want to know answers. We want to know what's going on in the budget, why the figures are there, what the figures are for. And if he's got a problem with me because I've called him out in the past on his practices and his attitude and his hostilities to townspeople on my sign on Route 9, that's my right. It's my property. He's been in before our board many, many times. We've never had a problem with him, ever. He's been in there for 2 hours, usually at our meetings. Anyone that's been before our board, when I'm chairman or not chairman, have never, ever, ever had a problem with me. I treat him with the utmost respect. This is ridiculous. Once again, you're holding his hand, Clarence. You're protecting him, and you can't continue doing this. We can't run a town like this. We have to move this town forward. He's an employee of this town, and if he's not going to follow the rules of everyone else in this town, then you should reprimand him. He should come before the board like everyone else does. And we have lots of questions for him. And it's not just him. It's everybody that's come before us. We've had questions. And they have to defend their budget and explain it to us so we can explain it to the people on the town's floor. So to say, oh, he shouldn't have to come in because of this, that, and the other, no, that's not the way it works. It's a big budget, lots of money, and I feel the figures I've seen, it's running at a 56% efficiency in the town. It's unacceptable. So we need to have him come in, and he's always been treated with utmost respect, especially by me. So I think you three should vote to have him come in. If one of you want to come in with him and hold his hand, let's do that. But let's get him in there and discuss the budget. We're talking about all the townspeople. We pay big taxes in this town, and we want to know where the money's being spent and why. so.
Does it use the highway department budget level funded?
We don't level fund anyone unless it's a small budget.
I'm not asking you the question, I'm asking.
No, I just answered it.
Did the budget that they submitted, Dave, is that level funded?
I only briefed over, no, not everything, no.
Is the total, is the total level funded?
No.
It's by, it's changed by how much?
Well, I don't know, I didn't go over every line, there's a lot on the budget. I can't remember every line.
No, I don't, I'm not asking every line, I'm asking the question of, is the total the same or different?
It's different, the numbers are different.
And it changed by how much?
I don't know, I can't tell you, I don't have the budget in front of me.
Well, I guess this one's, no, these are all the lines.
No, this is for the, our budget.
Oh, this is our budget.
Any of the other members out of here, they have any idea about,
Yeah, there's three or four of them out there. Ask them if they want to speak.
Did anybody from the advisory board want to speak in regards to this?
We didn't, Marie before, we didn't.
If you could just, Marie, if you just come to the mic, please, thank you.
We didn't really, we just basically glanced over the budget and we talked about level funding it because we feel that he needed to come in and answer some questions. So we didn't do any calculations. For us, the big issue was getting a department head in to answer some questions. So we just kind of, you know, said, we'll deal with this after we see what would come from this particular meeting.
And we had two or three questions just last night, just spitballing versus the salt to sand ratio, what we're doing in the center of town versus the outside. That's a huge cost and the seasonal worker. That was a huge issue as well, where we're going with the mowing, because we've been informed that the highway department doesn't want to mow anymore.
It's still up for discussion.
Yeah. And that's who they have to have the discussion with, because they have to implement the budget.
But Jeff, as late as last week, Jeff and Herb have not talked. And again, Herb's willing to do that. It's just that there has to be agreement that in fact is going to happen that way.
So they need to voice that opinion to the advisory committee so they can put a budget together for the town meeting.
All right. But does that have to actually have a meeting for that purpose? I mean, if it's sand and salt and there's a hiring or seasonal worker, I mean, those two issues.
Those are two line items, and then it snowballs over to either the cemetery that'll have to pick up the mowing or back to the rec committee.
Yeah.
So we're talking about three potential budgets just on one individual.
But for the moment, there is not an agreement, as I understand it, between highway and rec.
I think it all lies on the fact if Herb wants to do it or not.
And Herb's amenable to do it as long as he and Jeff can come to an agreement.
So, Linda, it falls to you. What do you want to do? Bob, did you want to speak on it? Or?
I'll just echo what they're saying. I'm just looking at
if you can just come to, Bob, can you just come to the mic, please? Thank you.
I'll just echo a lot of what the philosophy has been for us. I don't think we want to micromanage anybody, but I think for our due diligence for you as the Board of Selectmen, we have to ask some pointed questions and some rationale about what we're doing, okay, and why we're doing it. I don't think we could level fund somebody because I think that'll be a disservice to the department, especially if they legitimately are asking for more money. The only thing I'm concerned about is that consciously or unconsciously, you allow this to happen. You are setting a dangerous precedent for every department head in the thing.
Thank you
very much. That they will, that anybody could just willy-nilly, regardless of the players, but will willy-nilly try to circumvent the role that we have supporting you. And where I know
you're not supporting us. You're supporting the town.
The town, but I mean, as the board, for the way I look at advisory is that, admittedly, we're looking after the town, but we're also becoming the eyes and ears for you as the Board of Selectmen. That you don't necessarily have the time and the essence that we have of getting pinpointed when you're really getting down to line items and things like that. There might be good justifications why certain things are being done, about whether the truck or how much salt we buy, or whatever. But we still have to ask those questions. But again, I go back to the original premise, is that if you go along with this, and I know it's a personality clash, I also know that we're all adults, but you set a very dangerous precedent, because now you could have next year, everybody says, I really don't want to show up.
Well, that's what, you laugh, but that's what's going to happen.
I mean, and that defeats the whole purpose, not of only advisory, but of course, the oversight that we're mandated to do for the town. And I don't think a lot of this stuff can get hashed out at a town meeting. I mean, that's more excitement it is. But then you really get into minutia. A lot of the people only have half the story. They might have part of the story or whatever it is. And you don't want to turn your town meeting into a budget exercise. That's not the role and that's not the place for it.
Clarence, if a person didn't come in last night to not negotiate, but to explain a line item that was reduced by the advisory committee, that would have lasted probably a half an hour on the town floor, but it was discussed, it got taken care of, and there was no issues, there was no clashes.
I mean, there have been times on the committee we've agreed to disagree. I mean, and not all of us around the table agree with some of the recommendations, but we as a team, we're trying to put our best foot forward and to support the town. And if someone were to ask us or challenge us why certain decisions were made, then at least the chair can intelligently talk about it. Right now, we're somewhat being blindsided, because now we're saying, I don't know. And I don't want to get in front of a town meeting and say, I don't know. Or the chair get up in front of that town meeting and say, I don't know.
I tend now to agree with what Bob said, because if we do this, then we're setting a precedence and people feel that they don't have to come next year either.
Or they'll have to have a selectman present. And that's...
I mean, if that's a compromise you want to make, I have no problem with that.
I'm not willing to make that. We're not there to be...
I know that, but I'm just saying that. I mean, and there have been cases where the budgets are so small that we don't necessarily have to have the people come in. They'll send us a budget. It's level funded. And we'll take a look at it, see what they gave us on the narrative, and that'll be enough. But when you're talking some really major departments here, I mean, fire, police, school... And not school so much, but highway. I mean, you're talking a lot of money that's devoted to those departments that do a great job, but also impact our, you know, my role also on the assessor's office is we're also being always brought up, why is our tax rate X? Well, that goes back to how the budget's put together. So, said my piece. I hope I've contributed.
Couldn't have said it any better. Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, Linda, changed your mind. Clarence, has it changed yours?
No, I've got my HR hat on, and I'm sorry.
Respectfully.
I've changed my mind as well.
So, are you okay with mandating the individual to meet with the advisory committee? It's almost an insubordinate.
It's almost
a situation where he'll be placed in... I would be saying suspended until he meets with them. If he denies to me, it's insubordination, Clarence. Would you allow that in your business if a department head didn't meet with your?
But I have some other knowledge that has yet to be discussed with this board.
In regards to those two individuals?
Yes.
Openly or executive?
It's right now scheduled for executive.
So I'm going to table this discussion until another meeting or until your disclosure comes to light. Are we okay with that?
Okay.
Clarence?
Yes.
Okay. Item number 10, reviewing the selectmen's budget. Karen, your copy's there. I believe, were there three changes?
The only changes are the first white sheet at the top we already discussed last time. Everybody agreed to it. The only changes are three changes. Yes, I talked to Michelle, and she said $55,000 is what we funded for FY17. She suggested go up $5,000 to $60,000. And the CMRPC,
So back to legal for what reason, rationale?
Well, because we've had a lot of legal action lately, as you know, and she expects that some things might not, some other things are coming up in the future. You know, we still have lawsuits and...
With what we just did, are we comfortable with raising that, or should we keep it?
I'm uncomfortable.
With keeping it? You want to raise it?
Yeah.
No, I think you should raise it.
Yeah, well, that's my only issue. Okay, Karen, CMRPC?
CMRPC, for some reason it wasn't on the budget sheet, but it is in the budget, because every year we have to pay the delegate fee, which I gave you an attachment. It went up a little bit, not much, but I think it was $900 last year, so it's $924.05 for fiscal year 18.
Can we just say $925?
Yeah.
Are we okay with that, $925 even?
Yep.
Something we have to pay. And then the website email, $11,300, which is down a little bit from what we agreed on last time. But again, remember, if we don't use it, we'll be saving a bit of money. And even if we do, we'll still save money because we pared it down.
Have you given these new numbers to the advisory committee?
I just got the last of the numbers today, so no, I did not.
Okay. So I'll entertain. I'll entertain, well, we forwarded over our request. I'll entertain a motion to change those. We'll add one line item and change the other two.
I'll make that motion.
So the numbers reflected. Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. Other?
Yeah, I have a...
I think it's the only other. So there is a...
Yeah, I have another, Steve, if you have
okay. One. You don't want me to read this? It's the single session. This would be a mandatory.
No, I just don't think you have to because I just have to read it just in case.
It's the other before this one.
Well, this is.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to read the other because I think it's pertinent.
Okay.
It's in regards to, I believe it's free, correct me if I'm wrong, an anti-discrimination harassment laws and policies seminar that KP puts on.
The reason I have that in is because I thought you guys might want to discuss when we want to have it done.
Well, that's what we're doing now.
Okay.
My mind frame, I know I've seen emails stating late in the evening. I think we should do it if we want our employees to attend it during hours of employment. I think we'd be more prone.
They discussed it. I saw quite a few of them today, and they, when I was in, they said they'd prefer to have it during the day.
That's it.
Yeah. There were dates and times. I don't see that in this email, Karen. The last 2 weeks of April are wide open for Attorney Ecker.
Last 2 weeks of April, and then after that, really any time, she said. She said if you come up with a date, then she will...
And it lasts 2 hours?
Yeah, maybe we could do the 3 to 5 or something?
She said 2 hours, if depending upon how many questions are asked. So it could very well run to 3 hours.
Well, we could start it even at 2 o'clock.
Right.
Start it at 2.
But we also want some committee heads' chairs to participate. So getting the date out sooner is probably better. Yeah.
Well, it would be their availability.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to pick a tentative date or?
Okay, let me pick a tentative date.
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday?
Well, I think if we're going to do it, we shouldn't do it on the Tuesday that we have a meeting. It should be an off week.
I don't have the meeting date set by phone.
Okay.
So last 2 weeks are available of April.
Yeah, we usually don't meet the last week, so the Tuesday of the last week.
Do you have the meetings? So let's do this backwards. 21st, 4th, 18th. Do we want to do it on a Tuesday or?
On an off Tuesday.
An off Tuesday would be?
The 25th?
The
25th.
So
25th at 2 o'clock?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that
sounds good. So entertain a motion to allow the administrative assistant to reach out to KP to see if we can schedule said meeting for April 25th, 2 p.m. in the banquet hall.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Floor is yours, Clarence.
You're actually the chair, if we're calling an executive session. Oh,
no,
the other. Oh, good. Okay, so we're working on the financial administration of financial policies and procedures. We met last week. I gave you a synopsis of the progress that we've made. What I really want to talk about is that we're moving into the procurement section of the document. And because of this now there are actually three issues that relate to procurement, and they relate to a discussion by this board on January the 8th in 2013 with respect to large purchases, where the board referred to the department head based on a town meeting vote.
What was the date of that? I wasn't here.
Okay, yeah. And then I brought it up the last time that there was a policy of purchases over $3,000 that was agreed to on March 22nd of 2011, and subsequent to May 24th, 2011, as far as the idea of major purchases. And what I'm looking for direction from the board is that we've had a number of changes. Again, I attached
it. Are we looking at this one?
Yes, you're looking at that one. And I have, in my email to you, I went ahead and sent the recommendations for the first six pages as far as updates, the attachments being updated since the original document was put out. What I'm really looking for are really two things. One, the approval process to update the document and how you want that handled. And then the second period specific to procurement, because that's the next section that we're going to get into, is that we have the document. If this document supersedes the earlier, I'm fine with that. Or do the earlier 2011 and 2013 votes of this board, are they precedent?
According to town council, the policy in regards to the specific line item supersedes this book. So one of the changes might want to be to incorporate that policy and eliminate it.
So here's your struggle. That in January 8th of 2013, what this board agreed to is that a major purchase approved by town meeting did not need to come before this body.
Can I see that?
Yeah.
So Beth Coughlin emailed Punk Snyder on March 7th.
Yep. And I have...
Also, when looking over printed minutes from 1-8-13, found this other gem.
Yep.
17, which I'm assuming is line item agenda.
Yep.
Discussion of procedures to purchase equipment. This was passed over. It was determined that this item was placed on the agenda as a result of questioning arising from the proposed purchase of replacement one-ton truck. The question was, does the department need additional approval to purchase after they have town meeting approval? The board agreed that town meeting approval had final say. So without looking at this, I believe that it was probably an article on the warrant.
Mm-hmm.
The town voted on it. It did not touch the Selectmen fleet repair account. So this is apples and New York Mets.
Okay, well, I have three documents.
Yeah.
And, well, actually, I have a fourth because I have this document.
So why we're even reaching out to Beth, I have no idea.
I asked for input, and I got input, and that's what I'm sharing with you is input.
So these are the same, but this, again, this has nothing to do with the specific account that we're referring to.
Okay, so I then would come back to this document. What I'm asking, the key question, Steve, is this document that I'm dealing with precedent?
In regards to procurement, yes.
Yes.
In regards to the line item account that was used for the purchase, no.
Okay, now you're confusing me.
You keep bringing up things that you want to support your argument with, but
yes. Okay.
But you keep failing to mention, I believe it was the 2013 policy that required anybody to come before this board and the advisory board for purchases out of a specific account.
No. I am asking you about changing a document or that we're looking at revising the document.
Mm-hmm.
And one, I'm asking you how you want that to proceed, and then in the section
to revise that document?
Yes.
That would have to be done by the Board of Selectmen.
Well, that's correct.
Yeah.
And so we are now to the page of procurement. All right, we're here in our review of nine pages of the document. where we've had constructive feedback as to what's going on, as to how the document should read, and I'm at that point. And now we're dealing with procurement.
Mm-hmm.
I have three documents, and again, your point is that they don't apply, and if that's the case, I'm fine with that. So that this document that we have, that's dated a year ago, 2015, is the document of precedent. And I'm asking if you agree to that.
The one that we approved on June, was it June 1st or July 1st?
June 1st, 2015.
2015, that's the one that we should be working on.
That, if you want to update that, yes, when you're talking about specifics, I don't know exactly. This right here was for capital improvement and the precedent. Mm-hmm. I would say not looking at that.
Yeah.
Again, I'm a knee-jerk guy, so I haven't compared the two.
Yeah, good.
Beth's letter, I'm assuming, is an article, so it has nothing to do with this. This and this, I would believe that this would cover procurement.
But so that should be added to this, then?
If we really want to keep this, I would say that...
And that's what I'm asking.
We don't have a capital improvement planning committee.
You're in the midst of reconstituting
it. Yep. So if we want to incorporate that... I have no problem with it. If we want to add a line item for... My recommendation is to have a working, probably a morning meeting, specifically for...
Okay. So where we are is we're 9 pages into this thing,
mm-hmm.
and we have a lot of good feedback,
mm-hmm.
and with that, in my most recent email, distributing those recommendations, you have the recommendations.
But we can't discuss it back and forth.
No, and again, I'm just giving you information. So now what I'm asking, the first question is how would you like to proceed that? And if that's a morning meeting that you're looking to do, I'm good with that as well.
I think it should be a morning meeting by the board.
Yes, I agree.
We can either revamp it for a draft, or we can just take the vote on it to take care of it right then and there.
But my specific questions tonight would be that as we now are moving into the procurement section, what I would do is I would incorporate these, or the tenet of these two documents, into an addition to the procurement.
I'm not opposed to that, but we can have that discussion when we talk about it solely.
Okay, all right. No, I asked for feedback from the town employees and others. If they knew anything about this document and how to improve this document, I received some feedback. I appreciate that feedback.
Well, we did the same thing a few years ago, too.
But the town employees, we've sent this out, and we're supposed to get feedback, and a lot of them...
No, we did. We had several meetings.
Yes, we discussed several meetings at the last meeting. And now you're going over again with them?
Yes. There's no problem. I have no problem with that. It's a living document. It can be changed.
It's a living document. And again, the attachments that were received as a part of this, two attachments that we've gotten into the first part of this book, the attachments were old. Now we have the current documents, and we have the current procedures as it relates to the tribunal. So I'm feeling good about this. I'm not a negative, it's a positive.
No, the only, and I'll say in an open meeting, the only issue, and I've never discussed it with you, obviously violate open meeting law. My only issue, and now that I'm seeing Beth's name drawn into it, it's a discussion to protect the fire chief. And that's yep, we can agree to disagree.
Yep.
Any other discussion on the other?
No.
Correspondence? Excuse me. Senator Gobey has addressed the board that the governor's budget has been proposed. The Joint Committee on Ways and Means has scheduled the first of two fiscal year 18 budget hearings at the State House for March 9th, 2017 at 10 a.m. in meeting rooms A1 and A2. Hearing is open to public, and typically they schedule 8 additional hearings to be held around the Commonwealth. Also have correspondence from the WRTA. They are meeting to discuss a pay increase. The scheduling is not going to be affected, but they're talking about a cash fare from $150 to $175 and the one-way pass from $350 to $5. There are multiple locations and times. I'm assuming you can find this on their website. If you cannot, the first meeting is March 20th at Union Hall in Worcester. If you cannot find the times and locations, please contact the Selectman's office and Karen.
So the importance of that document is that the bus is going to continue to run.
Correct.
And we're talking a fare increase.
All right. So The website is www.therta, so therta.com, or contact WRTA customer service at 508-791-9782, and that is definitely the best advice as opposed to calling Karen, because they will have more information than Karen would give. Executive session number one. Mr. Holcraft, if you could please join us.
What happened to public access?
We had that already.
We did?
Yeah.
When you start at 5:30?
We did, yeah, as the agenda states. Did you have something to say under public access?
Well, yeah, a few things.
Welcome.
What are you guys doing with the furnace out here? Have you decided yet? You guys are looking for money, right?
Bill Simpson is responsible for that. We actually had another individual that contacted us. I don't know if you heard about that. Used to work for another company that's going to be into the bidding process. Was instructed to contact Mr. Simpson, and he's going to put together not only the bids, but potential grants, or the friends are going to help out too.
We have $20,000 in the reserve fund just for this type of situation.
All right.
And if you don't use it, it's going to get turned back into free cash.
All right.
So if you're looking, you said you were looking for monies before, it's here.
All right.
So I met with the guy on doing the stair lift out here this week. Last week. He's going to do a formal thing, but he said the staircase is good. The structural is good. The width is good. I asked him about the woodwork. He said he could put supports down to the floor so it doesn't damage the woodwork.
So the underlying question, is it ADA compliant?
Yes, it is. And it will take a wheelchair. I think it was up to 800 pounds on the lift. It will take a full wheelchair. It folds up when you're not using it. You might lose 10 inches on the thing, but we'll still have the egress on it. And what we do have to get signed off on, if everyone agrees and it gets voted in, is the building inspector has to agree to it too.
For what purpose?
It's in the state law.
For installation or for ADA compliance?
For the installation and making sure the staircase is suitable, the whole bit. He has to weigh in on it. Yeah.
That's huge.
Also, the price tag, he's doing a formal thing now for us, but the price tag, he said between 40 and 45. Warren Town Hall has one, and only one individual uses it in the whole town. But they use the second floor on a daily basis, and it gives them access. It gives them the free pass to use the second floor. And that's what everybody wants to do, is use the second floor. So if they don't want to spend $1 million on the elevator, I mean, this is just another option.
I would think that the friends could could come up with $40,000, $50,000 easily.
So the suggestion when I heard this is to connect with Bill, because Austin, again, I'm not saying it's right or wrong.
Yeah.
Right.
Is that Austin has a design. We've gone at this thing twice with feedback the same way each time with respect to a chairlift. And again, I respect your work. That we've never gotten to a point where that has been an approved process. So again, it was my suggestion to you to connect with Bill.
Approved from who?
The designs,
the
engineering firms that have done the work that we paid for each time have come back and said that we couldn't use a chairlift. Even on the committee that I was on?
We heard the same thing in the municipal planning committee.
I never heard that.
We heard it several times.
And I'm not saying it's wrong.
Well, that's why this guy's going to do a formal thing, because I asked him that. And he said, I'll get you all the data. So he said this is one of the best staircases he's seen to put this thing on.
So once we get that, then I'll...
So I don't know where you... I don't know.
I'm not saying no.
I'll personally reach out to Hopkins from the ADA, architectural board.
Will he come?
We can't. We have to do something with this building. We have to figure a way. So if this is an answer, great.
So is he going to come up here and do a proposal?
Well, he was already here. He was here for quite a few hours the other day measuring, but he's putting something together, and then I asked him if he'd come in and speak to you three, so he said he would.
Yeah, and
when we get to that point, if you want him to come in.
Well, we'd have to, because we'd have to prove it before the town meeting. Eventually, this one, next one, whatever.
It's yeah. Exactly. because we have to do back to the whole tumbling of restrooms, because that came up again in the employee meeting. It's without using the utilizing this building, we have no excuse to get a permit to be able to use the restrooms. It's crazy.
I mean, we can't even get two bathrooms in here, and we're trying to get an elevator in here.
You need the elevator to get the bathrooms.
I don't agree with that. But well, that's if you're going to put the elevator in.
No, we can't do the bathrooms unless we expand.
Expand the use of the building.
But I'm talking about downstairs right now, down here. Bathrooms down here.
Without expanding upward, we can't add on down here because it would...
Mass Historical said they wouldn't give us a permit.
Well, if you're gonna make another room into a bathroom, right? If you're going to take something else or add walls, they won't let you do that.
No, they won't.
I'm talking about using an existing room. You're talking about if they're going to put a partition right here and make a bathroom here, they will say no to that, correct? Okay, but I'm talking about using existing rooms that we have in this building right now on this first floor for bathrooms. One for unisex and one for a ladies' room. So the men and the people, the genders.
Well, that water's gone, so let's okay. Be done with that. So let's see what...
Anyway, I'll bring that forward when it comes.
So see what he's got to propose, and then we'll move forward with that. I think it's promising.
Well, again, we get it to Bill, because Bill has to go to Austin and work this thing through.
And that's where this guy should help out, because that's what they do. That's their cup of tea, right?
All right. Next.
All right, the animal control lady is going on maternity leave on 3/27. So who's going to take over? We have no assistant.
Has she reached out?
She did have an assistant, which I guess that she didn't hold out much hope for that assistant coming back. So she knows she is trying to reach out to have an assistant. And she was hoping that she could have this person come back and commit to it. Last I talked to her, that's what she was working on. I haven't heard from her lately. I can give her a call tomorrow and find out.
Okay. So we only get there's only like 600 maternity leave.
When though?
It's on 3/27.
Because technically we do have an assistant.
Who is it?
I don't know the name off the top of my head, but she's going to try to get her to recommit. Like
okay, that must have been something after she came before the board then, because at that point she didn't have anyone.
Okay.
Because we only got 653 in the assistant salary, so I don't know how you want to work that out right now. So, because if she's going to be getting, she's going to be taking her pay, or because I don't know if this one is on automatic pay.
If she's on leave, then I think that money should go to our assistant.
Also, another point is that last time I spoke with her, she said if the other person wouldn't commit, she also mentioned that Carrie's husband volunteered to do the job.
Okay. Someone from our board last night showed some interest, too.
I think you brought that up last night as well.
Right. Okay.
So if you can find out, and if Dave can reach out to you on who else is interested, this board would have to appoint somebody.
Okay. Everybody in town is questioning the recent thing in what's happened here about the when people in our departments put in bills. You know, they submit bills to different department heads, will put bills into the town accountant. What they have to do, I want to explain this to the townspeople, that you fill out a voucher like this, okay? You fill a voucher out. You put your name up here, the department head, the whole nine yards, the date. And then on the vendor's, on the first line, you put in what the bill is for. If it's for, whatever it's for, electric, or if it's for oil for that, if they're paying for the oil like the library does, you put it in a line here. Whatever it is, and then you total it up at the end, and then you total the second item on your whatever you're buying for your department for every 2 weeks, and then your third one, fourth one, fifth one, and then you total it up, and that's when you submit this to the accountant. And you also have to put receipts with this, so it can't be, you know, we had a certain department that said it was an honest mistake that a bill got mixed in with town's bills. That can't happen, because it's got to be written in, and it was written in, so it can't be an honest mistake when it was actually written in here. So that's how it's done. A lot of people are getting things, saying one thing and another. So you gotta itemize it, total it up, and sign it, and then it goes to the town accountant. So just so people know that it's not just something that just, it's willy-nilly, you throw a bunch of receipts at the town accountant. It doesn't work that way.
And to that point, in that orange binder is the updated documentation that relates to exactly what you just explained.
Right, but we're talking about what has happened.
Oh, I totally agree. And what we did is we updated, in the corrections that I provided copies, we've updated the process.
Are those based on, Carrie was supposed to put Excel spreadsheets together, are those hers?
So both the treasurer's document changed as well as Carrie's, and their procedures in both cases have changed. So we've got that .NET document.
In 1 second, what will that solve?
Just puts
the
into
change.
It puts into a computer format just like that, so you don't have to write it out, but it's still pretty much the same. It's just an Excel spreadsheet as opposed to handwriting.
Excel spreadsheet, but then the process behind the spreadsheet is also important, and that's what's done in document.
Okay. All right, now you guys ordered the highway department to wear hard hats when cutting trees about a month ago, 6 weeks ago.
I didn't.
I think it was longer than that.
Yeah, all three of you did.
It was about a year ago, wasn't it?
Oh, no. Time flies. Maybe 3 months ago. I don't know. I can't remember.
I
brought it up here at public access.
I remember the discussion. I don't know if we voted on it.
Yeah, you did.
I don't remember.
I remember the discussion.
Okay. Well, I'll bring it up again then. I think our guys should be protected out there somewhat when they're doing tree work, having hard hats on.
I would agree.
And that was expressed. I will say.
Yeah, they should.
So they should or they might. What's that mean, Linda?
They should for their own protection.
I mean, the other towns are doing it. I think we should do it. I mean, it's stuff's bing-banging off the trees 60 feet up. It's bouncing off the road 10 feet, and it's coming down.
So if we didn't take a vote, I'll entertain a motion to mandate that all outside overhead work by any department requires the use of a hard hat.
We follow OSHA rules.
Yeah. You don't want to put that in motion.
No. I'll make the motion.
Well, we already are, but this is just hard hat.
I mean, even when someone's using a backhoe and there's a guy helping out in the hole and that guy swings around and catches him just a little bit, that hard hat might make a huge difference to him, you know. He might get knocked in the hole, but at least he'll have his, you know, his head will still be there.
If you're doing a hard hat, does it also maybe require about eye protection? And if they're sore at anything, they need ear protection too?
Personal protection equipment, whether it's OSHA or...
So there's no motion out there, so what do we want to do? I don't know if we have chaps in the house. Hard hats for tree cutting should have the ear protection and the face shield already built into it.
The employees of the town should be afforded personal protection.
Yes, they should.
And evidently the person who's using actual saw should have ear protection on too?
Well, they actually have. Husqvarna makes a all-in-one system. So do we want to make the motion that... if the highway is not in possession of said equipment, they're to purchase and use?
I thought you said all departments, not just the highway.
Well, all departments aren't cutting trees.
Yeah, but I mean...
Water department?
Ear protection with the mowers. I mean, it's all PPO. They should use the appropriate personal protection equipment.
So do we need a motion, or should this be a memo?
We did it with a memo the last time.
But then it doesn't get followed, like everything else.
Motions and policies don't get followed, Dave.
Well, okay, all right.
Let's not go there.
Okay, well, I'm just...
But I'm trying to articulate a motion that is simple and going to be followed. Recommendations? Do we just want to go right to the highway department in regards to the trees, or we want to do broad, or we want to bring...
I'm talking, you know, I mean the water department when they're digging a grave. I mean, you get a backhoe swinging back and forth. I mean...
I think they all should have protective equipment.
Yes.
I don't know if it makes it any stronger. I mean, whether it's a memo or a motion, but I think it has to be coupled with, it puts the town in jeopardy from a liability perspective. Because some of these things, if you get injured on the job and you're not wearing the appropriate protection, the insurance company will not cover it.
Exactly.
So that is not just hounding you to wear the protection. We got, and it's also potentially a workman's compensation case too, which they could
we went protecting the employees, basically.
So maybe the motion should be to mandate all. To be honest with you, it should be a policy. we want to draft the policy up for the next meeting?
I can put it in the book.
Well, it won't be in the financial procedure book. No, it'll be a separate, safety policy.
We love to do policies and procedures. No, seems like this is the season.
But the I should be dotted and the T should be crossed.
Yeah, it should be a policy.
And it should refer it to OSHA standards, but that gets into OSHA training.
I'm not opposed to that.
Well, then we have to go to the advisory committee for training money.
Absolutely.
So did you want to work on that policy?
Sure.
Thank you. Anything else, Dave?
No. What's next?
And it should be for all departments, Clarence.
It is. It's all.
Yeah, that's.
And I'm not opposed to referencing OSHA. My recommendation may be to reach out to the high school to see if they have any policies, because they follow OSHA regulations as well. They train in-house for. We might even be able to piggyback off their training if they offer it. Anybody else wish to address the board that wasn't here for a public access portion?
Yeah.
Barbara? We have Barbara before you, Beth.
Just kind of an editorial.
Editorial.
An editorial.
Well, welcome back, Barbara.
Welcome back.
Nice to see you again.
Yeah, right. No, I'm just concerned. I'm really concerned about what's going on and how the town is not pulling together. We're in trouble.
We're in very bad trouble, Barbara.
We're in very bad trouble.
Yeah, if it's that proper
English. And this fighting back and forth is not good. I know the sign is a big, big subject. It's, according to that, it's injuring our youth, who in that school, half of them can't even read, and if the parents weren't...
You just picked a huge scab.
And if the parents weren't discussing so much of this at home, these little ones, which I've had a little bit to do with over the years, they could care less what's on that sign. Shame on the adults. And I've heard so many things, and I don't agree with the sign always. You can ask the person that writes it. I don't agree with it, but there are good things. But then I see this that comes down from the selectmen.
Own opinion.
Just
one
selectman's observation. But when you read between the lines, if you know what's going on, you see the jabs. Then you've got the people that are out there doing all the things on the websites and everything they can imagine to do it on. Some put their names, some won't even put their names. But all this going on and on and on and on in this town is tearing this town apart. And we have individuals that are afraid that if they go against somebody, that if they need an ambulance, it'll be delayed coming. If they have a fire, it'll be a delayed coming. They're afraid. And this is why we have poor attendance at our town meetings, because people are afraid to get up there and go against the people that are spending most of their time trying to get each other in this town. Mailboxes go down, fences get broke, all kinds of things are taking place. And I've been here just long enough, I'm sick of it. And I think that we need to get back thinking about restoring this building, thinking about building this town back to where it came from, and not be so eager to get your own opinion in there and hit somebody else. Everybody's being thrown under the bus every day of the week in this town. And I think shame on us. And I think the selectmen are trying to do their job. The advisory board spends many, many hours doing their job. And we go to town meeting for what? We have people that get up there and they've written their own things, always to their benefits. And the people that are going to the, spending all our money, going back and forth to the lawyers, back and forth to the lawyers. It's on our dime, on the taxpayers' back, that these individuals are seeking the advice of a lawyer right and left. And I'm sick of spending my dime over these petty people that are fighting all the time in this town. I don't know. And I know that this thing's coming up. Who's got the time to sit here and check to see if the doors are locked or if they're not unlocked or if we're having a legal meeting or we're not having a legal meeting? I don't sit around, come up here and check to see if somebody I don't like or a group I don't like has left the door unlocked. This is craziness. I just would like it out there. And I'm not the only one that's feeling this way. Not at all.
Yeah, I'm right there with you.
Thank you, Barbara. I feel the same way. Okay. I have had many Sorry people say if the same thing. No, you haven't offended anybody. You've spoken how you want to be. Things should get back to the way they used to be.
Beth?
Mr. Chairman, can I just comment
a little? After Beth, there's public access.
Oh, if you didn't.
No.
No,
you're up, Beth.
Okay.
Thank you.
One of the things that perhaps would be, it's kind of a technocratic approach to getting people back together, but one of the things that was proposed last meeting, and I didn't see it on the agenda for this meeting, and I was just curious if it was still under consideration. It talks about kind of moving the town forward, is that we were talking about reformulating the CIPC. I know you've been playing a role with it, Mr. Comtois.
I was actually in communication with Brian today for the school committee. They wanted to place Ms. Hosterman on it. I'm not in agreement with that. The bylaw states it has to be someone from that committee. She's not even a resident, let alone a committee member. He hasn't responded back if it's on his agenda yet, but it is a work in process.
Okay, I mean, you can, I mean, that would seem to be, I mean, frequently in some of the other portions of our bylaws, it says or a delegate. So if it's something that they're happy with, I don't know
why. To be honest with you, I don't see Kathleen being happy on coming to something like that. She does her 5-year capital plan, improvement plan out on her own out there.
Okay.
It should be a resident.
And that's fine, but it's good to know that it's moving forward. Okay.
I spoke to a couple of people here, and they're willing to serve on it.
And I think one of the keys is that we don't, you know, have, you know, if we involve more people with more opinions, we might be able to get back to the point where we're talking to each other civilly because we have those discussions before we hit the town meeting floor. So good. It's progressing. Thank you.
Welcome, sir.
I just wanted to quickly address what Barbara said about residents worrying about fire EMS response to them. I've been doing EMS for the town of Brookfield for 25 years. I'm the EMS lieutenant, fire for about 17 years. There will never be a delay in our response. I just want to make sure that's on record. And there's no preferential treatment on who we care for or who we take care of.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Maria, did you have anything? Maria? No. I saw your hand, Maria. Are you set? Maria? Pico? No? You all set?
Yeah.
Welcome, sir.
This is John Washburn. And I had a couple issues. My mother was able to pay her excise tax bill, and they said that, well, you can wait. And this is within regular hours of the tax collector. And they say, well, she's in the kitchen. It wasn't during lunch or anything particular time. But they says, well, you can wait. This is, well, we, you know, come up to pay our bill, and it's during the time period, I mean, to pay our bills. I've had my problem myself, and they say, just, well, leave the envelope for like a water department. Just leave the envelope. And these departments are open, but you can't even talk to somebody or give them your bill. So I just had an issue with paying the bill.
Well, there is a lockbox out in the office that they can put it. There's an envelope that they can put these bills in, and then the tax collector will turn around and she'll send them a receipt.
Right, but I'm saying these are hours that are on the board that say
Did somebody go to try to get her in the kitchen or?
Yeah. No, this is, no, we're not going to get her. You can wait. That's what she was told. My mother's 78. I mean,
I'm hoping it was a little nicer than a derogatory.
She said they weren't very nice. That's what she said.
Well, if you can.
Then she says, "Well, I got to come back another time to hopefully they're there
our,
this time."
Pass our apology from the Board of Selectmen to her.
You know.
Yeah, I know that during our meeting on the policies the other day, they came and got her. I mean,
we've always got people. If somebody's in here to pay a bill, I always get whoever.
I mean, it shouldn't be a tough time to come in, and especially if you pay the town.
It surprises me that if someone should have gotten Brenda, and Brenda would have come in a second. There's no doubt in my mind.
I don't know if she's there for 10 minutes or what time frame she was there. But
do you know what was a town employee?
Yeah, there was a town employee that she had talked to in the office. I don't know who the particular person was. It's not right. No, that's why I'm addressing this.
But what I was addressing, though, if she is not here, there is a lockbox out there that they can put the bills in. She'll send receipts back.
Well, I've been in town for almost over 20 years, and I don't even know about the lockbox.
It's right on the desk,
outside the office, or
it's in the office.
It's in the office.
Okay. Right. I'll have to check it out, I guess.
And she can also pay online.
Okay.
Is that access through credit card or check? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever's convenient. And I apologize through the town for your mother's inconvenience.
Mm-hmm. The other issue was that I wasn't a town employee down Lewis Field. I didn't address you guys, but I was let go because I had surgery. I was going to be out for like a month or two, and I had told the chairman of the board of the recreation board that I was going to be out for, you know, out for like a month, you know, and pre-thing. And I told him that, you know, I'll still do the trash, or my son will come down and lift the trash, or I couldn't do the physical labor, but it would get done. But after a little bit, I guess I came in to pay my tax bill. And to find out that they were already hiring somebody. I was like, what? And I contacted him, and it took a while for me to actually get a contact through somebody else to him. Jeff is his name. But I had a problem with him, and as far as I know, that I was gone. And there was bills that my hours and stuff that were submitted in that weren't paid and everything else. We had a big issue on this thing. And as far as I know, I was fired, basically.
I was heard that the bills were taken care of.
Yeah, I remember I talked.
This was after like 5 or 6 months after.
But you were taken care of.
I think most of it was. I think there may be a little.
I'm pretty sure
balance
I helped you straighten that.
Yeah, you had helped a little bit on that.
And the highway department takes care of it now.
Yeah. So
I don't know if you were technically fired. I think just
that's what I was told. He says we were going a different direction, and I was employed in the town for 14 years, and just to be let go like that wasn't very, I mean, service to the town, and there was no complaints, and everything else, just to let go. It seemed like they were looking for somebody to do the job again. You know that they had like 3 or 4 different people to do the job, and they.
I don't think we hired anybody else after that. Yeah. I think it was a volunteer after you left, and then it went right over to the highway department.
Yep. So I'm just putting my input in there.
No, but thank you for your service.
So, all right. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Executive session, Mr. Holcraft, you come forward. Before I entertain a motion to enter into executive session, do you choose to have this discussion in executive session? Would you like to have it open?
Well, with one condition. Okay.
Can't guarantee anything.
That the truth gets told by the one that's bringing this to the board.
Clarence. I don't believe this is going to be a completely civil discussion, but I would ask.
Well, if it's with me, it will be civil as usual.
But
I've never been not civil in this town, so don't keep saying that to me. I'm always civil.
So are you waiving your...
I'll have it in an open session.
All right, thank
you. Let the townspeople see the nonsense and where our money's being wasted. Whose phone is this up here that keeps beeping?
It's a recorder from TNG.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. That's okay.
Are Oh, I have one.
There's three copies in your class. Do you have one?
Yeah, I have one.
Are we going to bring, we're going to get a discussion on the yellow sign? We're supposed to have a, Steve, we're supposed to have a formal opinion on the yellow sign?
We have opinions attached to that, Susan.
Oh, yeah, we're going to get that out here.
So, hold on, Dave. Let me just disseminate all this information. All right, so this has gone a lot of different directions. The original complaint was by Mr. Snyder in regards to your sign, claimed that you created a hostile work environment. It was discussed through the board that the sign was protected under your constitutional right for freedom of speech. The opinion from Michelle came back stating that that was true. Mr. Snyder continued to reach out to town council, so the floor is yours, sir.
So I think we need to back up, and I think we need to recognize that there was a complaint on October 14th by Mr. Chafee, and again related to the yellow sign and the issue of something about sedatives or something like that.
That was years ago, and that's on my private property. That's on my private property.
Okay, so you're treating it as an individual, not as a town employee. You're acting as an individual.
I'm acting as a resident of the town of Brookfield. That's correct. It has nothing to do with any capacities up here in this town.
And so I would ask that then the October sign or September/October sign related to Mr. Chafee, you have nothing to share with the board as far as Mr. Chafee's mental health.
No, that was years ago. Whatever it said, I don't remember now.
It wasn't years ago.
Well, whenever it was.
It was on or about October 14th.
Just to refresh your memory.
Yeah, okay, what's, yeah.
Okay, so.
Yeah, that's a question. That was a question.
What's
that question? Sign is a question.
Oh, it's a question.
It doesn't say that he should be. It's a question. It's a question. Big difference. Right. Question.
So you were acting as an individual at that time?
That's correct.
Okay. So I had a complaint on December 8th as to the working environment in the town, and that I had somehow misrepresented something. What did I misrepresent?
I don't know. It depends on a lot of things. You misrepresent a lot of things.
But just pick one.
Right now?
Yep.
I don't have to right now. I get a list.
All right. So then I on February 17th, filed an additional complaint, which you do not have a copy of.
Yeah.
So I think we need to start at the beginning for the benefit of the Board of Selectmen. I believe it's important that we review several events that took place. Prior to the events of December, Mr. Holcraft was called into executive session.
Oh yeah, that was nothing. That was voted nothing. Yeah.
Would you be willing for me to share what I shared at that time?
That's not the complaint that we're bringing forward here tonight.
I believe it to be.
And that was all hearsay, and that was from a third and fourth party, which I told you was not true.
And that's why
that had to be thrown out, and it was propaganda that you brought into the town. Yes, it was from a third and fourth party, and it didn't take place.
You said something did not take place. Can I share what I shared with you?
Dave,
can you just let him talk, please?
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you.
I'm asking the question of Mr. Holcraft. Do you have a problem with sharing what I said to you at the conclusion of that executive session?
Yeah, go ahead. I don't remember, but go ahead.
Okay.
Nothing to hide.
What I said at the end of that executive session, because you, the alleged behavior that you was purported to you that you said that did not happen, and with that I said fine, that was fine, but that from the Board of Selectmen's point of view that we must take an action, and that action would be to suggest that profanity was not acceptable, and purporting you as a employee of the town or a representative of the town was unacceptable, that those behaviors should not occur.
That's correct, but those behaviors didn't take place. You got that from a third and fourth party, so.
Well, police report was filed.
No. No, it was not filed. No, you have a, you got a copy of it? I'd like to see it. I didn't see it.
I don't have it.
I didn't see it at that executive session either. Where was it?
The police chief reported it.
No. The police chief said that, the police chief repeated what she said, what she thought she heard me say.
Okay.
And it wasn't true what the lady said, because she thought I said something which I didn't, and that was corrected.
So you understand, David, that we had that discussion in executive session.
Yeah, and it went nowhere, right.
So whatever you say is on you.
That's right. I mean, if you're trying to get, you're trying to make some, you know, perceive to the public that I'm doing all this stuff, it's not true. That was resolved in the meeting. I shouldn't even have that executive
session. Well, it was, to be honest, Clarence, it wasn't even an issue.
It wasn't even, right, correct.
In the letter from the chief that came to us that we met, and you have no problem discussing this in open?
Go ahead. I got nothing to hide.
The letter stated that the chief of police asked if she wanted to file a complaint, and she specifically said no.
Oh, yeah, and I agree with that.
Okay.
Because I straightened that out with her. She thought I said something, which I didn't, and she said, okay, we were good.
Okay. But we still have an executive session.
Yeah, but it shouldn't have happened. You brought that forward, because you brought that executive session forward.
Yeah.
Yeah, for no reason. Just to jab me again.
So the town has...
Just to jab me again.
Yeah.
You're making stuff up, is what I'm trying to say to you.
Well, by the time I get to the page and a half here, I don't think I'm making any...
Okay, well, we'll get to that when we get to it.
All right, so following that, what I believe that took place was a retaliation on your part towards me as it related to that meeting. And that given that I asked you politely to remove my name from the sign at that time. And
what did I tell you? I said no.
Well, you grabbed that wastebasket right there and popped it up here on the table and slammed it down.
No. No, it was not slammed down. It was set down very gingerly. It was not slammed. And you can get that on the tape. It's on the tape. I watched the tape. There was no noise. It was set very gingerly.
Well,
see, now, like I said, if we're going to have this in open session, you're going to tell the truth. Okay? You're not going to exaggerate. You want me to slam that thing up? I'll show you what slam means. I set it up here very gingerly. Oh, I won't do it because then you'll say I was trying to hit you in the head.
I would not love that to happen, and it will not happen.
Steve, I'm very civil, and it won't happen. But to set him straight again, I set the basket up, and you know why I did that? Everyone in this town missed the point. The point was, the conversation was in the trash before we started it, because I have the right on that sign, freedom of speech. And if this board will read the letter from the selectmen, which you made them go back 3 or 4 times to the KP to get the opinion rewritten. Rewrite it. I don't like it. Rewrite it again.
So there were two. There was a draft that came in.
Yeah.
And there were that I was you and you were me, and I suggested that that was incorrect.
And it went back again to KP. And then you, did you call them after? You even talked to the KP yourself.
That number of times.
Okay. Now, we had a meeting with the trash can meeting. You said to the selectmen, especially to Linda Lincoln, you said to her that I'm not going to get involved. I'm not going to talk to the attorneys. I'm going to let Linda handle it. You handle it. I will not talk to the attorneys. And you just went and you just admitted that you talked to KP. And you cost this town almost $2,000 because you're jabbing me again. Yeah. So if we're going to stay in open session and be civil, tell the truth. But I'm sick of the lies in this town. I keep saying that. Don't lie. Don't lie, Clarence. And that's why you go on the sign.
So.
Go ahead. Continue.
With this, I thought I was directed to follow the relationship with the KMP as it related to this complaint. I was authorized?
No.
Based on Dave's statement, I remember stating that you were going to recuse yourself and Linda was going to be the liaison.
Because I was dealing with her on that.
You even went like this, Clarence. Oh, I'm going to let Linda handle it because I'm involved. I'm not going to handle anything with it.
Well, I certainly did receive a document, a draft document. I responded to that draft document.
Well, she sent it out to all three of us.
Right.
But you also had conversations with them on your own.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you said that you weren't going to get involved. And
well,
you
just,
so right there
I
again,
had
you made your point. You said you got caught again lying. So go ahead, continue on.
But that was a lie.
Oh, I know. You're going to twist that around too. 360 okay. Degrees.
So subsequently, I filed a complaint.
Yeah, okay, go ahead. We got almost $2,000 bill over this, yeah. And I'm on the advisory board trying to save money, and you're out
right,
here wasting
Dave,
it because you don't like
Dave,
the way...
Dave, you made that point.
All right, I want to make sure I did.
So what,
let him speak, Dave.
What KMP did is that they suggested that you could, at your sign, and that you could, as an individual, you could do what you've done, right?
Right, and that's why the trash can came up on the table. We already knew that. We knew that 10 years ago.
So did you think that placing the trash can was satisfactory behavior?
I think that was appropriate. Just using a prop. Now, tonight I was going to bring a shovel in just in case it got deep in here, but I decided not to.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave.
Yes, I thought that was appropriate for what I did. I was trying to make a point.
So what came of the conversations that I had with KMP is that they recommended a harassment class, a training session. Are you prepared to attend that session?
I haven't harassed anybody.
You're jumping ahead, Clarence. That's not for this complaint.
We'll wait till we get to the cartoon photo first.
No, we can jump right to
that. No, I want you to go through so you're happy. Let everybody in town know what's going on.
What I learned from both KMP and from my attorney
is
that I could, in fact, given the events that have transpired, I could, or Mr. Chafee could, apply for harassment protection order.
I don't think so, but that's okay. I talked to my attorney and they said you can't, you know.
Okay.
I also spoke to the police chief, and I've also spoken to other law enforcement, and I've also spoken to other people in other towns, and they're all laughing.
Okay. So then, let's move to February 16th.
Okay, let's do it.
And you have a document that...
I have the cartoon picture, yes.
Did you produce that cartoon?
Which, was that a picture of you?
Yeah.
I didn't produce it. I took a picture out of the Worcester Telegram. Yeah.
Yep.
And I was using that. We had that as a presentation discussing the procedures in town that you're confused on. Not the procedure books aren't confusing, you're confused.
So I guess the question is, do you refute that you made a copy of that document and placed it on the in the area of the
mailbox? Yeah, that's right, yeah.
You did that?
Yeah. I left it there. Placed it there, however you want to look at it.
You used the town's copying machine.
That's correct, I did, yes.
To take an image of me.
That's right.
Suggesting that I was confused.
No, I said you were confused.
Oh, okay.
But I was very to the point.
And then you placed it in front of the employee mailbox.
That's where I left it, by my file cabinet, yeah.
So that all the town employees could see that.
Well, I know. That's all, if you want to say that, I guess you can say that.
So, Mr. Chairman, given that, I think it's time for a timeout.
I don't think so. I think I'll respond to that.
Yeah, go for it.
You don't like the, just because it said you were a confused person, and the bottom of it, it also says confusion on procedures. And there was no confusion on procedures. You're the one that's confused, not the procedure book. You're making it confused. No, we're not going to get into going through it again.
Oh, yeah. You're suggesting...
You know what's funny, though? You voted for that procedure book back in 2015 of June. I sat out there.
It was my first meeting.
Oh, your first meeting. But you had no questions. You said that was great, and you voted for it. But now you're using this procedure book to try to protect a certain employee, so you're putting a big barrage up. That's why it all came out.
I actually began this before that whole...
No, I don't think so. No.
So anyway,
yeah,
in this procedure book, we have had 15 suggested revisions to this procedure book.
You can do that to anything that's done afterwards.
Sure. That's what we're doing.
Yeah, well, it's all a barrage, you know.
And so that within this, just for kind of where we are with this, is that there were 7 attachments. There were there are 8 more that weren't provided as a part of this. So I went and found the 8. So we now have 15 documents that we should be using. So that's the first thing. There were 27 questions and clarifications with respect to this.
Mm-hmm.
We're working down through them. We've worked now 9 pages of suggestions. In fact, you brought up one here earlier as to a procedure that's now in the markup that I would hope that the rest of the board accepts.
Oh, there was no problem with the voucher that we used today. No, I didn't
say that there was a problem.
Is that the one you're referring to?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, you can redo, I mean, I can take this sign-in sheet and say, hey, I could get 6 people. And they say, no, we should do this differently. That's what you're doing to the procedure book. I mean, you could do that 20 times and keep revising it and coming. Well, I think it's better if you do it this way.
Yeah.
You can do that.
We need to work to one document, one procedure.
Well, I thought we did that back in June. I thought everybody in town looked at it and everybody thought it was pretty good. You even voted for it.
2015, I voted for it.
That's right.
It's now 2017.
Yeah, it's a year and a half later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we have...
And you know the reason why this is being done. You know what it's all behind.
I started that long before this other issue.
Okay.
So where I am and what I'm suggesting is
okay.
that the actions of February 16, 17, that Mr. Holcraft has accepted that he didn't, in fact, did, are insubordination at the earliest, at the least.
Insubordination of what?
Towards this board.
No. It was about you. Now let me take a step forward. I didn't mean to interrupt you. You're an elected official, and that's communication. That's free speech on my part. It's no different than me come up here and public access and calling you a puppet, which I have in the past. And I've done that, and I've said my piece, and I can do that as a resident. You're an elected official, and if I left something in paper like that in there. That was part of our discussion at the advisory board that night.
The advisory board?
No, that was not given to any advisory board member. But we discussed your procedure, and that was part of mine. I didn't show that to any of the members or give them any copies. That was strictly for me. But we were discussing the newspaper article, tagged along with going over the procedures, as you asked me to do. And I did that with the board. And I also told you that at public access that we did that. So if there's a little picture of you that says he's a confused man, which I did, and it was left in there, maybe it was left deliberately, maybe I just left it and didn't put it in the file cabinet. Whatever the case may be, you're an elected official. This isn't romper room. What are you?
No.
You got thin skin? You can't take a little criticism?
People
talk bad about me every day in this town because I'm making people accountable in this town, and they don't like it. And you know what, Clarence? You're backing them. You're giving them the power to let them get away with this. People have to start being accountable. When I say people, I'm talking employees. You are giving them power to do whatever they want and get away with it.
You misappropriated town resources.
Wow, a piece of paper. Do you know that I haven't taken my money from the planning board? Two stipends. Do you know I donated all the drinks one year for the Memorial Day parade? And you're gonna, and all the hours they put in this town, and you're gonna come after me for a piece of paper and a little ink? You should be ashamed of yourself, Clarence.
I would suggest that you were intimidating town employees by placing that document in front of those members.
You're twisting things again.
I'm suggesting you misappropriated town equipment, and you intimidated town employees. Yay or nay?
Nay.
I definitely nay.
You're looking silly. You are looking silly up here.
I don't think so.
I think you are.
So I'll make a motion.
Let's not have a motion yet. Let's have a discussion first.
Yeah, let's have some more discussion here. This is ridiculous. It really is. We're wasting time like this.
It's not ridiculous, Dave.
No.
I think it is. But let's also remember this guy is the guy that several years ago came before the electoral board and said, I didn't live in town. And everyone up at the town hall says, the guy lives in town. But he still wanted to say, I didn't live in town.
Because you intimidated a town employee.
See, there you go again. You're backing people again.
I sure did.
And what happened at that meeting? 25 people were in here. What happened?
They showed up and said,
everybody in that room said, I lived in town. Except for one person that was in the room. And that was Punk Schneider.
Yeah.
And you crossed the town money then, too. And you look like a fool.
I don't think so.
Everyone in that room said it. Everyone in that room said it.
That you said to the Spencer New leader that you were a summer resident. That's your quote in the Spencer New.
No, I think they misinterpreted. I said I had a summer house on South Pond, and how he wrote it in the paper was up to him. And he misquoted me in the paper. You can't, what's in the paper is not evidence. So did you come to me that? Did you come up and say, Dave, you live in town? Did you come over and see me at night and say, Dave, you live in town?
Nope.
You didn't do that. You didn't even know who I was.
Nope.
So who put you up to it? Your little cronies?
I would say a town employee did, and I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, and that's my whole point that I just made. You're a puppet for these people in town.
So I would turn to the board and suggest.
So we have two issues in front of us. First and foremost, I'd like to put
You got a copy of the sign, Steve, from the attorneys?
The sign? What do you mean?
Yeah, we want a closure on this yellow sign here.
copy of the sign?
No, I want something from the KMP about what the attorney said about my sign.
Oh, it's all right here. It's public information now because it's an open session.
Okay, well, maybe you should...
Unless we don't discuss it, it's up to this board if we want to discuss it.
Right, maybe you should read it.
I'm not reading it. It's like 10 pages. I just read it while you guys were discussing it. But the main issue several months ago, and we had a town employee approach this office stating that it was, again, Steve Comtois, the infamous Steve Comtois, was dragging his feet on having this discussion. Yeah.
It worked, because if anybody was dragging, it was me.
It was you, 100%. So your hostile work environment complaint was ruled over a month ago, and you did reach out. You threw Herb's complaint in, and her ruling was on yours and Herb's complaint on the yellow sign, that Mr. Holcraft does have a constitutional right to do what he's doing.
The First Amendment as an individual.
There's no hostile work environment based on you and Herb's complaint.
Right.
So that goes to the fact that Herb has no reason not to meet with the advisory committee.
I'll accept that.
All right.
In the trash can.
So I don't know if you want to have a motion within this discussion to mandate Mr. Chafee to meet with the advisory committee based on this discussion.
I think we tabled it for this discussion.
All right. Come back.
I feel it's insubordination.
Okay, then he needs to meet with you in the trash can.
And what are the consequences if he doesn't?
Right. It would be insubordination.
So I'm going to entertain a motion to mandate that Herb Chafee, in his capacity of all department heads, meet with the advisory committee to discuss all budgets. What do we want to say?
I think you should include all department heads.
Why?
Right.
Well, all department heads. Have any budgets in.
Herb's the only one that's barking on meeting.
But still,
and
I think
he's... Until his complaint was resolved.
And I think you should include all the departments are on it. So it is a policy that all department heads will meet with the advisory committee.
Well, it's not a policy, it's a motion.
A motion, but you should put in the motion. All department heads.
So I'll entertain a motion that all department heads must meet with the advisory committee or they will be found to be insubordinate and actions will be taken by the board. Do we have a motion?
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Everyone,
I gotta say everything to the departments. Everyone has been very, very good about coming in, except for that one department. Everybody's been very cooperative, and the board has been reciprocal back to them.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So we're clear.
Department heads, yes.
All departments.
Just so we're clear, that document also incorporates that acting as an individual, that I or Herb could in fact approach the district court for harassment.
But we had that discussion two to three months ago, that this is a civil issue. You have all the power in the world to sue Mr. Holcraft civilly. 100%.
Okay. We all agree with that.
100%.
Good.
I wouldn't recommend it. This isn't the first time the town spent money for his constitutional right on that yellow sign. And to be frank with you, I'm sick and tired of spending the money on that yellow sign. Like Barbara said, Barbara and I, is Barbara still here? Are you?
I'm here.
Hi, ma'am. Barbara and I have had discussions on how we get Dave to stop doing some of the signs that he's doing.
Barbara and I have too.
More people in this room. Barbara, that's his desire. If he wants to put it on, he puts it on.
So let's deal.
It's freedom of speech, Clemens. I've been through this with my attorneys, and you're an elected official.
And I said that
in an elected official.
I said that in an earlier meeting. But now I'll come back into town hall.
So that's put to rest. So like I said, there were two issues.
Okay.
So the yellow sign is no longer an issue. It's considered not a hostile work environment. He has a constitutional right to do what he's doing. The second issue is a photocopy of your article from the Telegram Gazette with your picture on it.
Yep.
With him stating that you were a confused man. There is video showing Mr. Holcraft doing it. He is not denying it. All three of us have seen the video. I've spoken with Mr. Holcraft personally. Not mincing words, it was stupid. To do what you did was stupid. A complaint was filed with the police department. Unfortunately, it's not criminal. Stupid is stupid. Stupid is not criminal.
I think it's time for a timeout.
But this, so hear me out. And yeah. When this first happened, if we would have met, I would probably have agreed with you. But after the realization that, and Barbara talks about we're in a bad situation, there are some really bad people out there that hide under rocks, and we call them trolls. And there's some others that put themselves out there with their face. As everyone in this room knows, that a Telegram and Gazette article was written on me. In that article, it was referenced that I was attempted to be reached at my office, and I hope you got the message the next day that I did contact you back on Saturday. You never returned my call.
Well, I called you.
100%.
I called you at your home.
But I'm going there, so this is me making my point.
At work Friday.
And I returned the call Saturday.
You called Saturday at 4 p.m.
Approximately.
Yeah.
The article also say that you called me at my home. What town do we live in? These three people have to reside in this town. Do you remember the phone number that you called?
I probably have it in my car.
It was a Charlton number? And is
I
that,
don't think so.
I know so because I still have the recording. That plaque says my name on it, which means my dad has the same name. You called and left a message on my father's home.
I also have the phone number at your business. I was still...
I returned the call.
But they like...
But this is where I'm going with this. And I don't want to throw you under the bus. You're doing your job.
Well, I didn't do anything wrong, so you can't...
Well, you did do something wrong. You called my father in Charlton, stating that you called my home.
I've called you like 20 times. You never returned a call. The first time I returned a call was 1 in 24 hours after I called.
That was the first time I've ever gotten a call from you, sir. I returned every call. So the reason why I'm going with this, Clarence, to make a point, is that when my father got the phone call, he checked it and he reached out to me. And then they checked the website for the Telegram Gazette, and I got a call Thursday night from my mother crying in Hawaii because of the comments of these trolls calling me outrageous names. One of them, she started off, you could hear the tears in her voice. You're not a scumbag, you're my son. My mother telling me that I'm not a scumbag because of people, and I almost went the other way, I caught myself, hiding under comments of the Telegram and Gazette because they reached out to my mom and dad, who have never known any of it. And then Barbara talks about the yellow sign in the school, and you've made the point, and I totally disagree. With the rooms there are kindergarten and third or fourth grade way on the other side. These kids are not reading that yellow sign. So for some unbeknownst reason, my ex-wife had the desire to tell my 12-year-old son that I was in the Telegram. And then the emotion, I'm about to cry. For my 12-year-old son to call me and say, Dad, have you read the comments in the Telegram and Gazette? What do you say to that? We're talking about an individual, Mr. Holcraft, and we have people in this room that have called this board without you. Mr. Thoma was on this board back when we discussed Corey. There's a person in this room that called this board douchebags. We have people in this room. We have our EMT, head of our EMT, that posted on her Facebook that Telegram and Gazette article with the word karma question mark. Are you kidding me right now? We had an individual that took a copy of that of a different Telegram and Gazette article that you talked about policies. And I would agree with Mr. Holcraft. There's no doubt in my mind that what you're trying to do with these policies, because right after we met with Fire Chief Martel, you were in that office more than you've ever been in that office before, researching policies on how to protect how to protect Peter. And then to understand that you're in communication with Beth, mm-hmm. who's a person that everybody goes running to when they have a discrepancy with the Board of Selectmen. Why, I have no idea. She carries no water, in my opinion. For you to have that conversation just speaks volumes to the fact that you're trying to protect this individual. More power to you. I just wish you admit it, and that it is what it is.
Sure. I'm
using the documentation.
To protect somebody that did something wrong.
If the individual did something wrong, they're accountable.
And you, and the Telegram and Gazette reported prior to this that we suspended him for the purchase of the vehicle. No. That was not why we suspended him.
I made the motion.
To suspend him based on the fact that he put his electric bill on the document that they've just provided.
That's correct.
Physically handwrote it and submitted it, but it was a mistake. It's open session, we can discuss it.
That's what was said.
Yep. So when you see a policy like this, and for Dave, who, and if I'm throwing Barbara under the bus, she loves me, she won't hate me forever, might be for a day or two, she brought this article into the advisory committee. They discussed this article. That David made copies of this for every person that was there so they could read that article. That was the use of the copy machine. For him to put he's a confused man and place it, stupid. Stupid.
Freedom of speech.
But this, to me, this is equivalent to someone in this room calling this board a douchebag for someone that's not in this room that's on vacation. And why from Puerto Rico they're putting friggin' stuff on Facebook that it's karma that I made an arm's length transaction? I made myself clear on that. And for scumbags to call me scumbags, and I just didn't catch myself on that, because they are, they're scumbags. To call me a scumbag and to have my mother crying from Hawaii.
It's not right.
It's not right. This isn't right either. But we're elected officials, we have to have that thick skin. There's no criminal offense on this. I don't see any...
There's nothing there.
I see stupidity, but I don't see any course of action regarding this. I've said my piece. Linda, it's yours.
Well, I've spoken to Dave, too, about things that he said about his sign. And I also spoke to him about this, and I told him he shouldn't have done it, too. And he knows, but he claims that he left it there by mistake. That's what he told me. And I know, but I told him what I saw on the camera. I says, you left it there. It wasn't left by mistake. But things have happened to all of us. About 7.5 years ago, something happened to me here right in the town hall by an employee. I didn't get all this, everybody was against me for it, and it wasn't my fault. And the selectmen, I think...
You were assaulted in this town hall.
I was assaulted in this town hall.
And I was assaulted by the same person a few years later.
Nobody made anything of it. The selectmen supposedly at the time were told, they were going to suspend him, but they told him, just go up there and the Linda's not there. I even put charges against this man, and somebody knew somebody in the court, and it was all swept under the carpet. And that was assault. And my assistant was assaulted at the time, too. So you call things when somebody's assaulting you, it's worse than what has happened to you.
I feel for you, Clarence. I wouldn't want my name on that yellow sign. I wouldn't. I feel for Herb. I feel for anybody.
Yeah.
But there's, I don't believe in karma. I believe in cause and effect. If we do something wrong, we're called to the carpet.
Absolutely. As other town employees that represent the town. And I would include Mr. Holcraft in that group of people. He is a town employee.
I disagree with you, but I'm not going to go there. I'm not a town employee. I don't care what that little technical state thing says. I'm not a town employee. I'm a very dedicated, honorable person in the town of Brookfield, but I'm not a town employee.
So Michelle's ruled on this as well, stating that it's not illegal, there was nothing done. We don't have a code of ethics in the town. From what she said, we don't. Have you read her opinion?
No, well, hang on a second here.
Take your time.
Speaking of documents, There is a whistleblower.
That's for protection of town employees.
Yeah.
Protection. And so...
You mean the personnel bylaws?
Yes. No employee of the town or person acting on behalf of the town attempting to comply with this policy shall be dismissed or threatened with dismissal, disciplined, suspended, or threatened with discipline or suspension, penalized or other retributions imposed.
But that's
that speaks to you. You're blowing the whistle on this. Well, technically, Peter found it.
He did.
So that protects him.
Yeah.
That policy protects Peter from telling you about it.
Right.
It's a grievance.
But that has nothing to do with David.
I'm not a whistleblower. I got something to say. I just come out and say it.
I don't make any bones about it. My understanding of that is if a person, say, has problems, they go to the personnel board and they file a grievance against the employer.
And my suggestion to the personnel board, and we've talked about this, is to, in fact, add the harassment and bullying language there. You, at the last meeting, suggested that there was a period of time where it should not be added.
Town council also
Ms. Sell recommended that we didn't put a harassment anti-bullying.
Right, and so what I would like to have happen as a part of all of this action is that we look to the employee handbook that's hopefully going to be published at town meeting.
So what if Michelle, obviously that handbook's going to be reviewed by town council.
I doubt it's going to be ready.
What if Michelle advises again not to place that?
I would be very surprised.
Wouldn't, based on the fact that she's already done it.
She said that we shouldn't. She talked to me about that already. She said she does not think that we should have a harassment on it. She was the one that suggested that we have somebody come out and talk about harassment and sexual harassment instead of making...
So why did she advise that? This was years ago, so I don't remember why she... So,
well, this was just recently.
So why did she recommend not to place it again?
She, I can't, right off the top of my head, I don't know if she sent it in an email to me, but she doesn't suggest that it go in there. She suggests that somebody from Copeland Page come out here and talk to us.
So you're going to have somebody come here and talk, and provide training, and you're not going to have it in the documentation, I don't get that.
Well, we can put it in the documentation, and then if she doesn't feel it, she'd go in there.
I'm not opposed to that. And we did it. Jen brought it forth to this board through herself. And she was upset that Michelle advised against it, and then we went with Michelle's opinion.
Yeah, because quite honestly, had we had this in place, this would have been settled by the personnel board.
But this goes, again, is this harassment?
I think it is.
No, you're an elected official. I can say what I want to say. As long as it's not, bad. That's not bad.
Well, she's got something in here about that.
It's towards the end, I believe.
Is it towards the end?
It's almost like saying, Clarence, you made a mistake. I made a mistake. I'm confused about that subject.
Are you
I mean, that's nothing bad.
Are you going to apologize?
I might, if you'd be nice to me. I'm an honorable guy.
I think you need a vacation, is what I think.
Well, I need that too. I'm waiting for the good weather. Oh, yeah, it's coming. Good weather's not here yet. That's mine.
Seeing that this is a public meeting.
But not this, Barbara. Sorry.
I just needed to point out something here that's lacking pertaining to this.
Sorry.
Where was that here? I saw it.
I got to say one thing, though. I know my style sometimes is a little rough, but I'm trying to get a message point to our town, because a lot of times, depending who the leaders are, they don't seem to grasp what's actually going on, and they won't do anything about it on certain people, certain employees, whatever. And that's why the yellow sign appeared. And that's my opinion, and I'm not going to hide behind something. I hide behind the truth, and I put it up there, and that's what I do. It's more of a message board, let people know what's going on in town.
Did you want to keep looking for it, Linda, or are you also?
I saw it, and I don't know if it was in this one or another one. Because she said, once you become a public employee, you are...
A what?
When you are, elected or you're a public employee, you are open to all of these different things that do happen to you. Anything that anybody says about you.
But to put this in, it's not the yellow sign anymore. No. It's now come inside the town hall.
That's correct. It's in the town hall.
Whether the trash can was placed gently down on the table or it was not placed gently on the table, and to have that outburst at that time.
No, that wasn't an outburst.
That event.
What was wrong with doing that, though? I was making a statement.
It was unprofessional, Dave. That's what it was.
I'll go to that point. I'll say that's your opinion. But that was my way of making a quiet statement, which most people didn't pick up on it. Because as you see, the whole conversation and all the money you spent with KMP was in the trash can. And what I was trying to say, it was in the trash can before we started the conversation, because this town has had this conversation how many times? But you all missed the point.
It's not over.
But it's not. But I also talked to you, though, about what you did put out by the mailbox, Dave, and I said it was wrong. You shouldn't have put it out.
That's right. We've already determined that. That's...
So Clarence wanted to make a motion, so we'll entertain a motion, Clarence.
My motion was that he be suspended.
Suspended for what?
From the advisory board.
Well, that's what you want. You've been trying to get me off of there.
Dave.
Well, it's true.
Do we have a second? There's no second. I sympathize, but I don't agree. We put ourselves in these seats. And remember the first day you came?
I agree.
Congratulations, but be careful what you wish for. You just might get it. I've been thrown on the bus so many times. We talk about Barbara. Barbara talks about people destroying property. I've had property destroyed. There were some real bad people out there. I feel bad for society based on it, because you can't have civil discussions. You can't have an opinion that doesn't match your own, apparently, in some circles of this town. And it's horrible.
I think what happened to me 7 years ago was worse than
being assaulted,
having what he left about you, and nobody ever apologized to me about what happened.
But again, Barbara talked about stopping it.
Yeah.
It's got to be stopped.
Doing what David did at the mailbox is unacceptable. And there has to be some, and maybe I'll make another motion then, letter to file, that the behavior that occurred in that break room was unacceptable from this board.
If you worded it properly, I'd second it.
Yeah, I would too. I'd go along with that. A
letter to place
in.
How would you like
so our policy, and we've had this discussion that the advisory committee has to follow our policies as well, that we can remove them. There have been challenges in court, but ultimately the board can remove. So if we're under the policy of employees, we'd have to follow the discipline policy.
Right. And this is essentially...
The first part of that is a written... verbal warning.
Okay, so my opinion, we've given a verbal warning.
No, we have not.
No, it's a written verbal. It's in our world, it's the equivalent of a verbal.
What I'm suggesting.
But I believe we have it. Are you talking about the Verizon?
Yes.
No, that was nothing.
If you look at the minutes, I haven't, but just from recollection,
no,
we didn't do anything about it.
That was a sham too.
What I shared, that the behavior was unacceptable.
But we didn't take.
I think we both did. We both talked to him then.
That if it did happen, he denied it happening.
He denied it.
We had hearsay from a second source, the chief of police, through another person.
Right.
That was a hearsay. She never even approached the board.
He said, she said no.
We couldn't take it up.
Right.
So that hearsay, we didn't have a motion. We didn't give him a written verbal. So this would be a written verbal. This would be the first.
Well, I don't think that's fair either.
Okay.
That the events of February 16th were unacceptable?
If you
change, I challenge
change,
that. That's...
Change the word of unacceptable.
Okay.
Because legally it is acceptable.
Okay, help me understand.
I don't know.
That.
Well, through town council's opinion. I'm not even going to reference town council. I retract and rephrase. Through our police chief's opinion, it was non-criminal.
Oh, that's correct.
So then non-acceptable is not the right word.
I don't think there's anything there, Steve. I don't think there's anything there.
Inappropriate
behavior.
It's no different than me coming up here verbally and telling you what I think that you're doing or what you are, within reason. Same thing with what I left there. That's just ridiculous.
Inappropriate behavior and...
No, there was no behavior there.
Inappropriate behavior?
No.
It was.
Do you want to change the word from behavior to action?
Okay, I like it. Action is fine.
Inappropriate action and... next time, he should...
For full disclosure, I'm going to vote against this.
Okay.
But I want it to be out there
Yeah.
that we are taking action.
Yes.
Because if others that hide behind websites and Facebook and whatnot...
We are taking an action.
Can hide behind that and slam anybody they want. To me, this is just...
It's childish.
It's nonsense.
What you did was childish.
Yeah, that's
what you did. What you did was stupid.
Childish, but it's also freedom of speech. But that's the best. At best, that's all it is. It's no different than in the newspapers when they write little funnies about all the elected officials. What are you going to go after them and say that's bad action? No, you're an elected official. If you can't handle the heat in the kitchen cleanse, you should get out. It's my right as a taxpayer, and you're a leader, that I can criticize you. And that was my form of criticizing you.
That was it, malicious intent.
That was no malicious intent. Why, saying you're a confused guy? Come on.
So
you are a confused guy.
This shouldn't have been done here, David. He
is a confused guy.
So Linda, what about Facebook calling us douchebags? You were one of those douchebags. Is that acceptable?
No, that's not acceptable.
Did we take action on that?
Yeah. It's not like I was trying to hide something. I was out in the open.
No, I mean, he is putting here, it did happen here in the town hall. And
yeah,
it shouldn't happen again.
But he's an elected official and I'm a taxpayer.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, it does matter.
You're actually a town employee.
I'm not a town employee. And you don't even have an employee book that states all this stuff anyway. So what you're doing.
Get it eventually.
You don't have it now, though. So what you're doing is you're jumping ahead with what you're doing, and that's wrong. You know what's funny, Clarence, is we have town employees in this town that are hostile to the rest of the residents of this town. Hostile. They go around harassing people, chasing them through their yards, damaging their property, threatening to do things to their property, threatening to do things to their physical harm, and you just look the other way.
You're making the eyebrows, you know.
It's true.
People,
and you know it's true.
I'm guilty of exaggerating to make a point. That's just my teaching style and my personality.
Exaggerating? There's no exaggeration.
No, Dave, let me finish.
All right.
I see Clarence raising his eyebrows.
Yeah. More cover-ups.
You can't be that blind to realize that some of the people do that and nobody follows up on it.
And so...
I had to meet with a resident today, this afternoon, that's about to file a complaint in regards to that same exact issue. So
we had... And all power, that we have a complaint and we can act on that complaint. So that's good. So now we've just...
No, it's not good. We shouldn't be having those complaints.
We shouldn't have the complaints, but they do occur.
Yeah.
And so that they need to be brought before this body. So if Mr. Holcraft has, as we started this conversation earlier, if we have knowledge of something, then that should be shared.
Agreed.
And so we just heard, and I would like you to tell this board... Who?
Okay.
No, Dave, no, but we're not here for that.
No, but no, but he's going after me for being hostile, and we pay an employee.
So I'm gonna
talking about an employee in town.
I'm gonna try to settle this.
I'll answer
real
your question
quick.
If you want an answer, Clarence.
Without a motion and a second, would you be willing to make an apology to Mr. Snyder for this?
Yeah, I'll make an apology.
I'll accept the apology.
Okay. I apologize to you.
Thank you.
For making a funny in the break room. Kitchen.
Are we good?
I am going to draft something.
You still want to make a motion?
We need to have a record.
I mean, this is record.
If Karen has a record of this being the first written verbal warning.
Well, no, we didn't take a vote on it.
All right. We need to document.
Well, my desire was not to make this motion to have an apology from Mr. Holcraft to you. So you're not willing to accept his apology?
I've accepted his apology.
Are you willing to?
If the minutes of this meeting document that we had this conversation, then yes, I guess that's satisfactory.
You vote to approve the minutes as well.
Exactly.
And that should go into the minutes.
No, it doesn't go into the minutes because we didn't vote on it.
So what?
But it's part of the conversation. It should go into the minutes.
It should be.
You need it for a verbal written warning. You need a motion to accept and a vote to accept. The discussion can be had, but it's not a legal.
No action was taken.
It's not a legal verbal.
But it's something I feel is something that was discussed and it should be in the minutes for me.
Well, the minutes that we discussed the issue, that it's
yes,
it was stupid.
No, but it should be say that we said that a verbal warning.
He's got to make a I'm not going to have the minutes reflect that there was a verbal written warning unless there was a verbal written warning.
Well, then I look to Linda to provide that motion.
I'll make the motion.
For what? What's the motion?
A verbal warning should go in the file. I mean, should be in the minutes of the meeting. So yeah, maybe this doesn't happen again.
You have to state what the motion is. He just wanted it to be a verbal...
A verbal warning, yes.
And that's what the minutes are going to reflect.
And the minutes will reflect.
A generic...
A verbal warning, yes.
So I'm not going to write out a verbal warning?
No, you're going to... A motion was made to issue Mr. Holcraft a verbal written warning.
And have it in the minutes of the meeting.
Well, you don't have to put it in the minutes of the meeting. It's just in the minutes of the meeting.
Well, what's that mean?
It's just that we're recording the events of this evening. That's what it means.
And I'll entertain that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
You made it.
You made it.
Oh, I made it. Okay.
So discussion again, I'm voting no, based on my experience with people out there, and we're elected officials. And that this world needs to get better. It really does.
It does.
It does.
It really does. Any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
And I am a no. Vote carries. Any further discussion?
No.
Thank you, Mr. Holcraft.
Yep.
Barbara, did you have a comment that you would like to discuss now?
All I wanted to say is listening to this whole thing going on reflects right back to what I was saying at the beginning. And I just want you people to know that I read the piece in the newspaper, and when I read the piece in the newspaper, I didn't think much about it other than what's out there all the time. But then when we went into our meeting...
You're talking about the policy piece?
The policy was handed to us, and David went and copied it, and he made a flub on the machine. And so he had to do some of the pages over again. But the article itself, I requested to have it printed and given to the members because... They were going to go line by line down through there, what was said in the paper, and see how it matched up to what was in our policy. And so that we could better understand it. And so it was my request that asked him to do that. So when David printed it, he put it in the machine so that the part that came out to us did not have a picture on it. We only had the article that we went by. And the only one that had the picture on it was I had the original and David had the copy of that. And what he diddled on it, which, how many of you have ever diddled on the paper while you've been sitting there waiting for something to be done?
Not left it intentionally, though.
And I'm not sure it was left intentionally. That would be hard to prove, other than the fact that it was in the vicinity of where the file cabinet was. And this is what I was trying to point out in the very beginning. This back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, trying to nail somebody. And I wish it would stop.
I agree with you. Think it has to stop.
Thank you. Yeah. Any other business? I will entertain a motion to adjourn, 8:01.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
No discussion. All in favor? Thank you, everyone.